Good evening. Once again, welcome to our midweek service here at Calvary Chapel in St. Vite. First, we want to pray, worship the Lord, and then get into His Word. Tonight, we're going to look at Micah chapter 1. We're going to look going through on Wednesday nights before our pandemic started. We were going through the minor prophets, and so we're going to continue starting this evening. So, let's pray first. Heavenly Father, we come before you in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. We thank you for your protection in our lives. And we ask you to continue to protect us, Lord, from this virus and what's going on in the world, Lord. But I pray, Lord, that we would not have fear, Lord. I pray that things would be able to open up soon, Lord, so people's lives could get back to some resemblance of normal. But we just look to your hand, Lord. We look to you for your help. Have mercy on this world, Lord, the whole world. Have mercy on our village here in St. Vite. And have your way in each of our lives. And use this, Lord, to touch people and reveal yourself to them. Be glorified tonight as we worship you, Lord. Be exalted. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
No. Thank you. Glory is beyond all compare. I will call. Amen. Well, pray that you've had a wonderful week so far this week. That the Lord has been good to you. He's always good to you. Just hopefully you've noticed it. It's just good to get together and open up God's Word again. So this evening, you know, what we're doing is we've been going through on Wednesday evenings. We've been going through, before the pandemic started, through the books of the minor prophets, and we left off, our next book, we left off there in Jonah, and now we're in Micah. Now, for those of you who are tuning in, and maybe the first time with us here in this series, I do want you to know that minor prophets doesn't mean that they're lesser prophets than the major prophets. Really what it is, you know, in our terms is their books are smaller. That's all. But you know what? God used them just as much. They were just as powerful as anybody. Just as God can use you or I. You know, I love the Word of God and what it teaches us. You know, because many times, you know, we put people on pedestals. You know, we call them saint. Saint this or saint that. When our Bible says that if you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you become a born-again believer, you become a saint. You're one of his saints. Saint James. You know, not that I want to run around and call myself that, but we're saints, each one of us. And so it's great. You know, there's not, God doesn't take somebody and say they're so much better than this person and I can use them more. He can use any one of us, just like he did the prophets and the minor prophets. So we're in the book of Micah chapter 1 this evening. Now, just a little background on this. Micah ministered around 740 BC, and his ministry lasted about 40 years. At that time, Israel and Judah were having a civil war. God's people, the land of Israel was divided. 10 tribes in the north, 2 tribes in the bottom. Israel in the north, Judah in the bottom. They were having a civil war, and it was pretty bad. It was a real, real bloody time. Okay? It says in 2 Chronicles 28, verse 6, it says, "For Pekah, the son of Remaliah, slew in Judah 120,000 in one day, all valiant men, because they had forsaken the Lord God of their fathers." So it was a pretty bad civil war that they're having, killing each other. Not getting along, obviously. Let me take care of that smudge I got there. And so Micah, when we look at Micah, Micah was he was the only prophet that ministered both to Israel and to Judah. And he was from Judah. So he ministered to both. He would also see in about 722 BC, the Assyrians would come down and annihilate the northern kingdom just of Israel. They'd carry the people away into captivity, and the tribes would be lost. The lost tribes of Israel. That's where that comes from. That's when it happened. And so now Micah was also, at the same time, a contemporary with Hosea, Amos, and Isaiah. And the interesting thing about Isaiah, Isaiah prophesied to Hezekiah the king. And that was in the south. And Micah was mostly focused on the northern kingdom of Israel. But he brings Judah into it also. Now, because Isaiah and Micah were pretty close, Micah, was mentored, good possibility, by Isaiah. It has been said that because of Isaiah's writings and Micah's writings, some people think that Micah just ripped off Isaiah, because what is in Micah is in Isaiah. And it's there. So people say, well, you know what? This is the book of little Isaiah, because they're in both. Let me share with you something. In 2 Timothy, Paul wrote about his protege, Timothy, his child in the Lord, the one who was working with him and under him. He said in 2 Timothy 2, verses 1 and 2, he said this, "You therefore, my son," speaking to Timothy, "be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. The things which you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also." Timothy, take exactly what I'm saying and share with someone else and pass it on and have them pass it on. Just share it. Do exactly what I'm saying. So there's no ripoff in the kingdom of God. There's nothing new under the sun. So, what we see here in Micah is the message being either passed on that he learned from Isaiah, or God gave it to him separately. God can do that. Give the same message to two different people. He can do that, because that's God. But it doesn't matter. The message is going forth. So, I look at myself and I don't come up with a brand new revelation every time I study the Word and I get ready to teach. I don't have a bunch of brand new revelations. I use a lot of things from my pastor, Brian Larson, and from John Corson and Chuck Smith. Those are my main three that they're commentaries that I like to use, and I use a lot of their stuff. I pass it on. Once in a while, God gives me something, or I put it in my own terms, in my own way, the best of my ability that I can do that. But I quote them quite often. So what you hear is you've been taught and discipled, pass it on to other people. Share it with other people. It's okay to do that. You don't have to be all original in your sharing and make it, because there was only one original, that was Adam. He was the only original man, right? So a lot of what we see in Micah is Isaiah, so people would say, well, why even have the book of Micah? Well, Isaiah has 66 chapters, and Micah has 7. So you can say, this is the Reader's Digest version, the condensed version of what's in Isaiah, so you can get it all in one little shot, okay? So there you go. Maybe you've never read Isaiah. Well, now you get a little taste of it. Maybe this will cause you, but you know, I want to read that book of Isaiah and see what's in it. It is obviously a great book. And we need to hear things over and over and over and over and over again. 42 years now, walking with the Lord. Knew I was a Christian a long time before that, but didn't walk. I need to hear some of the same things I heard in the beginning. I need to hear them now, over and over, because I'm human, I forget, you know, I stumble, I fall. I need to hear the same things over and over. So if you heard something, well, I already heard that. Well, you probably needed to hear it again. So don't say, well, I already heard that. You know, I remember my Pastor Brian, he said some of the same. I was sat under my Pastor Brian in person, Miss Ann and I did, for 26 or 27 years. Heard a lot of the same stories. You know what? Every time, man, it was fresh and new. Because I wanted God to speak to me. I wanted Jesus to speak to me. So the Lord ministered to me, and it was fresh and new. So, there you go. Listen to what Peter says in 1 Peter 1, 12 and 13. He says, therefore, I will always be ready to remind you of these things, even though you already know them, and have been established in the truth, which is present with you. I consider it right, as long as I am in this earthly dwelling, to stir you up by way of reminder. We need to be reminded. Why? So we can be established firmly in the truth. And we need to be reminded of it. If you don't think so, the next time you're in the middle of a trial and you're going, oh, no, no, no. Well, remember the last trial you already got through it. God brought you through that trial, didn't he? So, he's faithful. We need to be reminded of that over and over and over again. So, I don't need to impress you coming up with new things. I'm just going to share with you what's in God's Word and what He tells me to share with you. So now, let's read Micah. Verse 1. Verse 1, first, Lord Jesus, once again, this is your word. Minister to our hearts, Lord. You are the one that has life. Holy Spirit, you reveal things to you. I have nothing. You have it all. So teach us in Jesus' name. Amen. Verse 1. The word of the Lord which came to Micah of Moresheth in the days of Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah, which he saw concerning Samaria and Jerusalem. Samaria was the capital of Israel, the northern kingdoms. Jerusalem was the capital of Judah, in the southern kingdom. Hear, O peoples, all of you, listen, O earth, all it contains. And let the Lord be a witness against you, the Lord from his holy temple. For behold, the Lord is coming forth from his place. He will come down and tread on the high places of the earth. The mountains will melt under him, and the valleys will be split like wax before the fire, like water poured down a steep place. All this is for the rebellion of Jacob, and for the sins of the house of Israel. What is the rebellion of Jacob? Is it not Samaria? What is the high place of Judah? Is it not Jerusalem? For I will make Samaria a heap of ruins in the open country, planting places for a vineyard. I will pour her stones down into the valley and will lay bare her foundations. All of her idols will be smashed. All of her earnings will be burned with fire. And all of her images I will make desolate, for she collected them from a harlot's earnings. And to the earnings of a harlot they will return. As we read this, you'll notice there in verse 2, all the peoples of the earth. Yes, his judgment is coming down on Israel and Judah. But it's a prophetic picture here also when he says all the peoples of the earth. Because God has a case against the whole earth. He is coming and he's going to judge this earth in the end days. And we've been looking at that when we studied Revelation. So let's just look at this little part here, just this little bit, as a prophetic picture. There is this huge judgment that's going to come against the whole earth at the end of the age because of the rebellion, because of the evilness of this world, it's just, man is just in rebellion. And look at the things that happen in this earth. And it's getting to the point where God's just going to say, that is enough. And he's going to judge this earth. And we know when that happens, we read exactly what's going to happen when this what this is pointing to right here, this scripture is a prophetic picture, is in Revelation chapter 6 through 18. You can read it there. You can see what's going to happen to this world. It's kind of, you know, it's scary, but you know what? It's going to happen. Now, in this that we're looking at here, for that time, Israel and Judah, in verse 5, it kind of gives them the reason this is going to happen. In verse 5, it says, they're going to be judged because of their idolatry in their high places. You know, also there I think in verse 7, it talks about the idols being smashed. The idolatry in high places. You see, they would come together in the morning in their temple, and they would do their sacrifices to the Lord, and their prayers and their sacrifices to the Lord. And then in the evening, they would go to the high places, and they would sacrifice to their idols and their false gods. You know, God just wasn't going to put up with that. And you look at today, we have the same thing today. You have governments, you have people in high places in the government. Well, they will have their prayer meeting in the morning or their prayer breakfast, and then they're out at a cocktail party that evening, sacrificing to their other gods, you know, and being hypocrites in the things they would do. You look at some of us who go to church, you know, we go to church on Sunday morning, and then that evening we're out, you know, doing drugs and drinking and sex, you know, sexual immorality and stuff like that. And you know what? It's just, those are idols in our lives. Those are false gods. And we're not giving, you know, we're being a hypocrite when we do those things. And I'm talking about believers doing those things. So, in Revelation chapter 3, verse 15, by the way, this message has hope in it, okay? Also, so, you know, if you're hearing this, go, whoa, I don't listen to this. There's hope coming, okay? But Revelation 3, 15 and 16, you know, the Lord is writing a letter to his church, the church of the end days. He wrote seven letters to seven churches, which represent seven different time periods and seven different churches in each time period also. And the last time period, he wrote this letter, and he said this, Revelation 3, 15 and 16, he says, I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish that you were cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. He's speaking to the church. He says, you know what, I'm going to have you hot or cold. Get in or get out. Get off the fence. I'm going to puke you up, man. I'm going to throw you up. If you're lukewarm, it's not going to put up. You would rather have you all the way one way or all the way the next way. That way, at least he knows where you stand. One foot in and one foot out. These people here in this time of Micah, they couldn't decide between the things of God and the things of the earth and the idols that they worshipped. So God was going to be judging them. And all I can say to that is, Lord, help us. Lord, help each one of us in our churches today and those people that consider themselves as Christians. Help us to walk the walk and not to lay trips on other people and worry about what they're doing. Just take care of what we're doing and love people, okay? Well, in verse 8, Micah says, because of this, this is in Micah chapter 1, because of this I must lament and wail. I must go barefoot and naked. I must make a lament like the jackals and a mourning like the ostriches. You know, jackals, you know, they have a horrendous noise. Because he's seeing what is going to happen to his people and to his country, it breaks his heart. And the prophecy there, it breaks his heart because he sees the destruction, what's going to happen to people. He wept and he wailed and he howled. You know what? When Jesus came into Jerusalem and he knew what was going to happen to his people, that Jerusalem was going to get trampled and people were going to be taken because they had rejected their Messiah. And they were going to be taken into exile. and they weren't going to be in their land for 2,000 years. And they didn't come back into their land until 1948. He saw that. It says in the Bible, it says, Jesus wept because his heart was broken because he loves his people. He didn't want that to happen to him. That was not his plan. But it's the choice that we make and people make when we decide to turn our back on the Lord. You know, prophecy, when we see these things, when we study the book of Revelation, many times we're going, whoa, that's cool stuff, and wow, that's going to happen. You know what? It should break our heart to see what's coming, on what's going to come on this earth. It should break our heart. We should weep. We should cry out to God for mercy on the people that these things are going to fall upon. And God will have mercy on them. When they cry out to him, he has mercy on them. He will. We should have compassion and brokenness instead of, wow, Revelation, what a cool book, you know? Just a thought there for us. I've been guilty of it so many times. I mean, I love to study Revelation. That stuff, whoa, it intrigues me, but at the same time, how sad. Well, back to Micah verse 9. For her wound is incurable. For it has come to Judah, that's his land. It has reached the gate of my people, even to Jerusalem. An incurable wound. The point of no return. It was going to happen. It was like, there was not going to be repentance. People were going to change. And they were at the point of no return. You know, Proverbs 29 verse 1 says, a man who hardens his neck after much reproof will suddenly be broken beyond remedy. There was a song in the 70s called, the harder they come, the harder they fall. You know, when you fight, when you're stiff, it's a hard fall. When you have a lot of pride, it's a long way down when you break. And when you're stiff-necked, your brokenness is bad. If you humble yourself first, the brokenness won't hurt as much. So don't let your heart get hardened. Don't let it get hardened to the point of being broken and no fixing. And he's really brokenhearted because he knows it's coming to his hometown. So in verse 10, he says, tell it not in Gath, weep not at all at Beth Le'Akra, roll yourself in the dust. Go on your way, habitant of Shephir, in shameful nakedness. The inhabitant of Zanim does not escape. The lamentation of Bezalel, he will take from you its support. So he is telling all these places here, you know what? He's kind of doing a play on words here. It's interesting. Let me just share a few of them with you. When he says there not to weep in Gath, well, you know what? Gath means weeping. So he's saying, weep not in weep time. Even the place of weeping, don't weep there anymore. And then in Afra, it means dust. He says, roll yourself in dust town. He's just a play on words, just interesting little things here. In verse 11, Zaphir means beauty. Walk in nakedness and shame in the city of beauty. You know, it's just a play on words. You know, this stuff is going to be bad. Just humble yourself. You're broken before the Lord. And Zanon means march town. You only escape by marching out of it. Just a play on words there. And there's more play on words, but we're not going to look at all those. So let's read verse 12 to 14. But the inhabitant of Marath becomes weak, waiting for good, because a calamity has come down from the Lord to the gate of Jerusalem. Harness the chariot to the team of horses, O inhabitant of Lachish. She was the beginning of sin to the daughter of Zion, because in you were found the rebellious acts of Israel. Therefore, you'll give party gifts on behalf of Moresheth Gath. The house of Akzib will become a deception to the kings of Israel. And so on and so on. You know, there's no way of getting out of this judgment. It's coming. But, as I shared with you earlier, there's also good news. Even though judgment is coming, there is still hope. Listen to verse 15. Moreover, I will bring on you the one who takes possession, O inhabitant of Marishah. The glory of Israel will enter Adullam. What's that talking about? That's talking about the Messiah, Jesus Christ. He's going to come. He's coming back. The glory of Israel is going to come back. So you know what? What I love about this is, number one, it's a prophecy of Jesus Christ in the middle of all this tough stuff. A prophecy about the coming of Jesus. And prophecy, like these, that this whole book here, this whole chapter is about, prophecy never ends in darkness. Did you know that? Prophecy never ends in darkness. The final chapter is always the glorious light. There's always that light at the end of the tunnel. And that's comforting to me. Because God is a God of love. You know, in Revelation chapter 6 through 18, it's dark, it's hard, it's scary, it's tough things to think about. But it doesn't end in chapter 18. There's 19, 20, 21, and 22. Our future home. Jesus coming back, making things right. It goes on to our glorious future that God has for us. Because God is merciful, loving, and caring. You know, people read some of the stuff in the Bible and they go, God sounds mean. He's not mean. Anything that you see there's always a reason behind it. That you see, well, that doesn't sound right. There's always a reason behind whatever God does. And it's for love. And it's for good. Let me read you that hope. Just a little bit of that hope. Since we've read all this other stuff, let me give you a little hope. Our future. Just one little part of it. In Revelation chapter 21, why don't you turn there? Verses 1 through 7. Revelation 21, 1 through 7. The tribulation has happened. We are with the Lord now in eternity. And John has this whole vision, this whole book, he's written this vision he's got of Revelation, this whole vision. He says, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth passed away, and there was no longer any sea. That's the part that's like, wait a minute, we like the sea, but I'm sure it's going to be better. But I like this earth. You'll like the new one better, because it'll be perfect. There won't be any death. You know, let me just read it. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, made ready as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is among men, and he will dwell among them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be among them. And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And there will no longer be any death. There will no longer be any mourning, or crying, or pain. The first things have passed away. Did you hear that? God himself will be amongst us. He will be living with us. There is not going to be a separation. There's not going to be any evil, any bad stuff anymore. And he's going to wipe it all away. No more mourning. No more crying. No more pain. No longer any death. No longer any COVID-19 or any other virus like it. Gone. Don't you want that? Isn't that what you would love to have? Where you are right now in your life, stuck in your house, locked up? Especially here in Belize and some of the other countries, locked up. Wouldn't you rather have that? I'm getting it. Miss Anna and I, we know where we're going. We know our future home. 100%, not a doubt in our minds. Well, he goes on to say, finishing this chapter from Revelation 21, and he who sits on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new. And he said, write, for for these words are faithful and true. He puts the explanation point on there, right? Because these things are faithful and true. This is real. You know what? The Bible says, heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will never pass away. His words will never pass away. They are more real than the air, the chair you're sitting in, the couch you're on. God's word is more real than that. It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And I will give to the one who thirsts from the spring of water of life without cost. He who overcomes will inherit these things, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. And son means men and women, okay? Wow. Wow. I love that. But let's finish verse 16 of Micah before I continue on with those thoughts. He says there in Micah, verse 16, chapter 1, make yourself bald and cut off your hair because of the children of your delight. Extend your baldness like the eagles. You see, they shaved their head when they were broke. When brokenness came and bad things happened, they shaved their head. It's one thing they did in humility and in brokenness. He says, just do it. Shave it all off because judgment is coming. And judgment is coming in this world. Now, Jesus says this. Because, you know, the Lord said there, that in the end of Revelation 21, he says, I will give to the one who thirsts from the spring of water of life without cost. You know, the Lord says this in John chapter 4. Jesus speaking to the woman at the well, verse 13 and 14. Jesus answered and said to her, the woman at the well, everyone who drinks of this water will thirst again. You know, she's standing there with this water getting out of the well. Hey, everybody who drinks this water here, they're going to thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him shall never thirst. But the water that I will give him will become in him a well of water springing up to eternal life. That water, the living water, the Holy Spirit coming in and living in your life, flowing out of you. You will never thirst again for spiritual things because you will have them. You will have eternal life. It will be flowing out of you. That's what he's talking about. You'll never thirst again. You're probably sitting, you in your life, you're probably thirsting for that water right now. You probably want that. You want to have that because that's where peace and joy is. That's where life is. That's the water you want. Not just water. You have to get another drink later. Matter of fact, I keep getting out of my cup and drinking, don't I? Just humble yourself before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ of the Bible. Humble yourself and surrender to him. Give your life to him. Get into reading his word. Because, you know, the word of God is considered water, the water of life. Because it refreshes you. It gives you life. There was a professor, I guess he's a professor, Dr. McCash, a man that Miss Ann and I met well over 20 years ago. We were at a friend's house near where we lived. They were visiting in our area, and she invited us over for dinner, and we had dinner with her and her husband and Dr. McCash and his wife. And his wife, they were early 90s. He taught at a Bible college for 50 years. His wife was dying of cancer, and these two had the peace of God all over them. And so I'm sitting all alone with Dr. McCash in the living room, and it was like, whoa, man, wow. Here's this gem of a man who's got so much knowledge about the things of God. I said, Dr. McCash, what is it? In a simple sentence, what about the Christian life? What is it? What do you do? And he said, I'll never forget, a deep voice, he said, well, Jim, wash in the word daily. And it just went all over me. Wash in the word daily. Wow. And that stuck with me. Because, you know, our minds get full of junk. There's junk that comes in our mind. We can't help it. It comes in through billboards, through television, through what people say, what people wear, what's going on, people talking. Stuff comes in. You need to wash it out. This is like a washing machine. It cleanses your mind. You know, in Romans 12, verses 1 and 2, it talks about renewing your mind daily. How do you renew your mind daily? You spend time in God's Word, and you renew your mind. You want victory in your life, you get in God's Word. And when you know Him, God's Word comes to life to you. My suggestion is this to you, those of you who don't know Him, to read it. But those of you who do know Him, when you sit down, but I read God's the Bible and it doesn't make sense, and you know it's hard to read. And well, get a version that you can understand. And then when you sit down to read it, pray. Lord Jesus, Holy Spirit, would you show me something out of the Word today and minister to me? In Jesus' name I pray. And then open it up, and wherever you're at in the Word, read it and let Him speak to you. Don't be looking for anything. Let Him speak to you. He will, because this is alive. This book is alive. How could I read a book for 42 years and still be reading and learning? Because it's a spiritual book. And if you haven't got it, if you're born again in the Spirit, there's no way for you really to understand it. But when you are born again and the Spirit of God lives in you, it comes alive, and it's alive. And I want to give you that opportunity now to come to that place, to have the Holy Spirit come and live in your life. You see, the Bible says we've all sinned. We've done something wrong. And because of that, we can't be with God. Because God is sinless, and no sin is allowed in. So we need our sin to be dealt with. And so God made a plan. When Adam and Eve fell in the garden, He'd already made the plan that He would become a man, Jesus Christ. God would become a man. Jesus Christ is God. And He would live a perfect life. And then He would walk to a cross and shed His blood for our sin. That would pay the price so that we could be restored in eternity with the Father. That's why it was done. That's why He had to do it. And He did it, and to seal the deal, He came out of that grave 3 days later. And you know, I'm sharing this with you right now, and you know it's true. Because the Holy Spirit is ministering that to you right now. This is truth. Your mind and your intellect might say, oh, that's a bunch of garbage. The Spirit of you, or outside of you, is ministering to you and saying, that is truth. Don't ignore the Holy Spirit right now. Submit. And say, you know what? I need forgiveness of my sin. I want to go to heaven. So pray with me. Lord Jesus, I know I've blown it. And I'm a sinner. I need forgiveness. And I know You went to the cross and shed Your blood for me. And I receive that right now. Lord, thank You for forgiving me and dying on the cross for me. And thank You, Lord, You came back to life. And now I ask You to live in my heart, in my life. Help me to submit my whole being to You, Lord. And to walk with You and to know You. Make Your Word come alive to me so I can grow and have strength and have victory over those things in my life that I need to deal with. And I thank You, Lord. I thank You. And I believe that You've done that and You come into me right now. So I surrender my heart and my life to You. Make me a man or a woman of God and use me now, Lord. Because this is good news. And I believe. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. If you've done that, tell somebody. Start reading the Bible. Get into a church fellowship. You know, you can't go to them right now, I guess. You can go online to many of them. You can always watch ours Sunday morning, 10:30 Belize time, 6:30 Belize time on Wednesday nights. For those of you in California, that's 9:30 and 5:30. Or Calvary Chapel, Truckee, or whatever church you're from. You know, there's many, many online churches right now, and grow. And then when this is lifted, get into fellowship and share with people. Because this world, this pandemic is just the beginning, my friends. This world is in trouble. So God bless you and walk with Jesus. Amen.